Okay, this is the Lucifer effect too. I forgot a couple things that I wanted to, a couple of key points that I wanted to cover in the first one. So just so you understand, I kind of skipped over two major points that I really wanted to cover. One was the connection between the Lucifer effect and power. Back when there was news stories about, we had our little prison where the guards were, they posed, what is it, Abu Ghraib, out of Baghdad, not too far from Baghdad, they were holding prisoners, and they showed all these pictures that we were supposedly torturing prisoners, and we scaring them with dogs, and doing things to them, humiliating them, making them naked, etc. This doctor that wrote the Lucifer Effect testified for the guards in this case. And he explained, and he actually helped them, because they were gonna get a lot worse sentence than they did. I'm not sure if they got off or not. But he testified on how powerful and empowering being part of a group is. So, and he also discussed a little bit more into detail about how good people do evil things, because violations that, and I'm probably saying it wrong, I forgot the name of the prison now, but Abu Ghraib, something. All the bad things and pictures were done by the night shift, okay? And the reason that they were done by the night shift is there was less supervision. They were told there wasn't clear instructions, there wasn't clear guidelines. And they were told, these guys are the enemy, they're out there killing your fellow soldiers, they're killing Americans. So we have this enemy, we know that we're fighting this enemy, and they were told things like, take the gloves off, and help us break them down. So when the guards were at night with less supervision, and they were being a group, and they were guarding these guys, and their job was to tear them down, take off the gloves, they started doing things that they thought was part of the mission, that they thought they were being part of the group, that they were doing good things. And, you know, did they know right from wrong? Probably. But again, in this Lucifer effect, where he explains how our human emotions, how we get tied up into groups, how since we were kids we were taught to be that way. You know, you got your, be true to your school, you got your favorite football team, you got your favorite this, you got your, you know, this, whatever group you're in, everybody promotes being loyal, stick with them, don't be a snitch, don't be an outsider, don't question, things like that. So this doctor testified on behalf of these guys. They were young kids, they were in the military, they were indoctrinated. Now the military uses this type of indoctrination all the time. When you go in the military, everybody gets their head shaved, so there's no individual. I can't have long hair, you can't be identified. They want everybody to look the same. They shave your head, they take away all your civilian clothes, they give you the same uniform with no rank, no name tabs, no nothing. You don't know anybody, and all you know is everybody's got bald head. And then they try to turn you against each other, they try to make you as a group, they tear you down. When one person makes a mistake, they make everybody pay. In this prison experiment they did, when one of the prisoners did something wrong, they made everybody pay so the other prisoners would get on a guy that messed up and correct him and tell him, don't do that because you're pissing us off. So they would cause more isolation even among the groups. And this is done, I mean, to me it's just so normal. It's done in politics, it's done in government, politicians, it's done in the legal system between attorneys, cops, defense attorneys, judges. There's all these groups and cliques, and they all have the same goal, and they all have feel part of this group, and they have to protect this group, and we can't turn in this group, and you know, you want to be loyal to your group, and there's a greater good to your group. Well, those poor military guys, and I say poor military guys, I mean, they're young kids, lack of supervision, somebody didn't stop them, they let them go wild. There was another incident where some military guys were pissing on the enemy, and everybody had a big thing. Oh, they killed these guys, and then they urinated on them. Oh, how disrespectful. Oh, how could, look. Believe me, when somebody's trying to kill you and you kill them and live, pissing on them is the least of your worries. Okay? People don't understand how massive things you know, these traumatic events in your life, significant emotional events that change who you are. The loss of a child, someone close to you dying of cancer, just seeing things, seeing your buddy shot and his head blown off next to you, escorting a casket of a buddy of yours that was killed by, you know, another group, mainly the bunch of sand idiots over there. Whatever the enemy is, you know, in Vietnam, you know, we called them gooks. That was so disrespectful, and how could you do that? And, you know, the soldiers were mean, supposedly, and they were shooting children. Well, yeah, because children are walking up with grenades and blowing you up. If you walk up, it only takes one child to walk up and blow up my buddy, and the next child that walks up, when I say stop, he gets shot before he gets close enough. Sorry. If that bothers you, tough. And in a loser effect, people will be like on the outside looking in. You don't have all those emotions. You don't have that connection. You don't have those experiences that cause you to justify what's going on. You just look at it through your filter from the outside saying, how could anybody do that? Well, in the prison experience, they were shocked that these young college kids could become prisoners and guards in less than 5 days and got so out of hand and used so much force against each other and were so unpredictable and breaking down and that they had to stop the experiment. So in life, where it comes to the, there was another, when this doctor was on Dr. Phil's show and he was talking about this book, he brought on an army and he was a ranger. And I think the rangers, they call them tabs. If you get a tab, I thought a tab, well, you know, there's special forces tab, there's air assault tab, or there's ranger tab. But evidently, I think that in this thing, he was referring to a ranger is considered a tab if he has the ranger. If you go through ranger school, which is a high-end school for the Army to get to be a ranger, you're part of the top elite. Just like if you're in the Navy, you get to be a Navy SEAL, you're a top elite. You know, every branch has their own. They're always trying to make you move up or want to think you're, you know, when you're in the Army, everybody in the Army's great. Then you got your unit, and everybody in your unit's great, and your unit's better than the other unit, and then this unit's, and then, you know, so they have this, you're always trying to belong or get into the best or the strongest, smartest, fastest, whatever. It's all about competition. So, and it plays to the ego of young males that are predominantly in the military. You want that kind of fight force, you want that arrogant, ego, aggressive fighting force, because that makes a good adversary when you're in a war. So this ranger, this kid, actually robbed a bank with his military unit and did not know he was going to rob a bank. Now when you hear that, you're like, are you kidding me? How can you not know? Well, again, through this indoctrination, when you're in a Rangers, you never question your higher person. So this guy's team leader was God. Whatever he said, you did. You didn't question. And one of the ways that I can't remember what unit it was. I was working with Special Forces and Rangers in Germany. And they were talking about when they were home on leave, they had to answer the phone, kill, kill, kill. When they were home on leave, they had to answer the phone, kill, kill, kill. Because if their sergeant called or their supervisor called and they didn't say kill, 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 then they were going to be in big trouble. So even when they were away from the unit trying to have some R&R, they had to answer the phone, kill, kill, kill. Well, that's that indoctrination, that's that respect, that's that chain of command that, you know, I always heard in the military and in police work, oh, chain of command, never break the chain of command, always listen, you never question authority, don't question orders, follow orders, you're part of a team, don't be an outsider, but, you know. So this guy never questioned his tab, who was his boss. He never questioned him. So this sergeant used to make them do what's called suicide check. And when he said suicide check, he'd hand one of the guys in his unit a gun and say suicide check. And to prove their loyalty and trust for him, they would not check the gun. They would put this gun he handed to their head and pull the trigger. Now, they were trusting that he wouldn't give them a loaded gun. But the suicide check, mentally, what this doctor was saying, was a very strong imprinting of the mind that you don't question me. You're willing basically to kill yourself. I'm going to hand you a gun, tell you to put it to your head and pull the trigger, and you'll do that. And if you don't do it and you question tab, well, you're in big trouble. You never question tab. And the kid, I mean, I call him a kid. I think he was 18 or 19. And he ended up robbing his bank. In his defense, his doctor testified for him, luckily, and helped him a lot. Or he went to jail for a long time because they robbed a bank with military weapons and everything. They just weren't their POVs. But anyway, he was doing a suicide check on this guy. And he goes, the first time this guy handed him the tab, he cleared the gun to make sure it was clear before he put it to his head. And he got in trouble. He got the gun yanked away and said, don't ever check me. Don't ever question me. Don't second guess me. When I hand you a gun, I tell you suicide check. You put your head and pull the trigger. You don't check it. That's trust. That's respect. And the kid was like, yes, sir, no problem. And so he did it. And he used to do this periodically. His sergeant would just come by, hand him a gun, suicide check. Yes, sir, click, hand a gun back. So this mental programming and tearing down, that's kind of the extreme of it. But to lesser extremes, you still have lesser people that haven't been through the military training that maybe not take that high of a level to get them to commit. Everybody's got a boss that you're kind of not maybe afraid of, or that you're kind of a little worried about, or you think that, man, you don't want to cross him. There's always people that are above you that you're kind of like, ah, man, you don't want to cross that guy. Oh, my God, he's this person. He's that. I remember when I worked for the DA's office, regular cops who didn't see the DA thought the DA was God. Oh, man, you got to talk to the DA, man. I just see the DA. I've never talked to him. And they just thought it was really odd and weird that, you know, working in the DA's office, we'd have a conversation, we'd pass him, call him by the first name. It was no big deal for us. But for the regular cops who weren't up there, they were like, dude, man, when the DA's around, we're like really nervous because he's the only guy that can really charge, and he can protect us and he can charge us, so we got to stay on his good side. So there's always going to be this level of control no matter where you're at. And that young ranger on Dr. Phil, if you can find the episode on this Lucifer Effect, it was a really good show. And I mean, this guy, what his tab did, his sergeant did, it says they would do practice and they would do training. And if we had to hit this building, what would we do? And he'd go by Dairy Queen and say, if we had to hit this building, what would we do? Well, we'd approach on this entrance and we'd go here and we'd cover, and here's the escape route. And here, so they were always thinking, hey, this is great. I've got a sergeant that's trying to help me and train me, and we're going to be better and we're a more effective team. So when we get in some sort of urban combat, we're going to have all this experience and knowledge and pre-planning. Well, so then he goes by a bank. Okay, if we were going to hit this bank, what would we do? Blah, 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 blah. They did all this. They did this. Like, okay, let's do a dry run. So they all went in there as a dry run to do surveillance. And they looked. He came back out and he questioned them. Well, what did you see? What did you see? And they all kind of gave their input. And he was like, okay, good. You saw that. You saw that. Next thing you know, this kid's driving them. And they're pulling guns out of the trunk going in. And this young kid is like, man, they're not really going to rob this place. This kind of seems kind of odd. And he said, what really hit him is when he saw one guy come out or come running out of the bank or something, and he had this really scared look, and he's like, man, this doesn't sound good. And he goes, I started to drive away because I thought something was wrong, and something inside me said I can't leave my team, and I went back, and I picked him up. And we went back to the place, and next thing you know, he's home on leave, and the FBI kicks his door in because they didn't think they were caught. And you know, and his defense was, well, I didn't know. And everybody went, man, you're crazy. You ain't going to pull it. You didn't know. Well, this doctor went in and kind of said, hey, he's been indoctrinated and trained so long, he's been so pre-programmed, he's been so pushed to the extent and the limit that you don't ever question, you better do what you're told, and, you know, that it's very feasible for him to have been in that situation and not be able to think, not step outside and go, hey, you know, those guys who were taking the pictures at Abu Ghraib prison, they couldn't step to the side and say, hey, this isn't good. They felt so comfortable doing it, they actually took pictures because they were proud. They thought they were fighting the enemy. They thought they were helping tear down these terrorists so the CIA could come in and get more information, because they were so belittled. Because we have torn them down so low, they're not going to resist when they're questioned, so they're going to give us intel. So they thought they were doing a good thing. Now, when the people on the outside saw it, they were like, oh, my God, our military's torturing people, and you still got freaking liberals running around. We don't torture. That's, you know, whatever. Look, I'm not trying to be the moral cop here and say what's right and what's wrong. Everybody has their own moral compass. But in this Lucifer Effect thing, there's things that are done along the way that get you to where you don't question, and you do what you're told, And the more the impact that has, depending on how you look at the person who's telling you this. So in the horse world, when you're looking at somebody that supposedly has Pirelli trained, or fourth level dressage, or fifth level hunter jumper, or owns a horse that's worth $50,000 and has won this award and that award, and is a trainer, and is a trainer of this horse that won this medal, and the higher you put people up on things, the less likely you are to question or to disagree with them or to go against them or the flow of things. And that's why I see in the horse world there's so much misinformation. You've got young, mostly young, you have a lot of older people that came in that don't know nothing but what they were a kid. They had a pony that they sat on when they were a kid, and suddenly they owned a horse as a kid and rode, so when they're in their 40s or 50s, they want to ride a horse and relive that experience. So you have a lot of unknowledgeable people getting into the horse world. So they don't have a lot of lessons. So they have to look and find other people who they can look up to or who have more information than them. So in a horse world, because 90% of the people get out of horses in the first year, there's a lot of people getting out of horses because of injuries or whatever. There's a lot of people getting out, which means there's a lot of people, new people coming in. There's a lot of young, impressionable horse people, not necessarily young in age, but young in experience or horse ownership or horsemanship skills, that they just don't have that frame of reference. They don't have that ability to critically think and go, man, putting a bit in a horse's mouth and pulling and ripping on the gums, causing pressure on that bone, just doesn't seem right. But all these people who are winning awards do it, and all these other people in clubs do it, and everybody, every picture I see has one in, so it must be okay to put a metal pain device in a horse's sensitive mouth by his gums and teeth and pull on it. It must be normal, because everybody does it, so they don't question it, and they do it. And then the more they do it, the more it becomes normal, and the more it becomes normal, the more it becomes ingrained that that's the right way. And the harder it is to say that isn't the right way. It's very hard to step out of the horse world and to look at something, to look at an animal and go, this doesn't seem right. It doesn't seem like a relationship to have with a horse when I'm constantly elbowing, nudging, whipping, running him in circles and making the horse respect my space. That doesn't seem reasonable. That's not what I would want to do if I was a horse. It's very hard for people to do that. So when I do it, people get this very defensive, like, he's talking about me. He's attacking me. Because he's saying I'm wrong. Then that defensive wall comes up, and then they want to attack me or come against me. But it just promotes the ignorance in the horse world. And I mean, I just, daily, I mean, I still get people, I mean, my hate mail's gone down because I've taken down Facebook and I've got out of that crap. And the only two things I have my YouTube, and then I can ban you from the channel now. So I just ban you from the channel. And the first idiot comment, you're banned from the channel. I don't care. And when my emails now, where I used to read the emails, as soon as the email says anything about, I have this or can you help me, I just delete it. I don't read it. I don't go into it. I don't try to help. I just delete it. So I'm not giving advice, so I'm not pissing people off. So that's what happens when you get into an environment or a situation where you have rules, you have hierarchy, you have people that you look up to, and you have people that are down, and you have new people coming in that you're training, that you're indoctrinating into your belief system, and they better not go against you, because if they do, they're going to be on the outside. We're going to ostracize you. We're going to isolate you. And it's very hard for somebody on the inside to go against the inside. And this Lucifer effect just, I mean, even if some of those prison guards in Abu Ghraib that didn't want to do what they did, their ability to go against all their peers that they work with, that they have to trust, that they have to, it's the same way with cops. People go, oh, there's no thin blue line. Cops clean their own house. Cops have to depend on other cops. It's very, very difficult to say to a cop, dude, you can't be beating on that guy. You can't be doing that because you're questioning your team. You're going against your group. You're going to be isolated. People are going to say, hey, you can't trust him. If he's questioning me about this, man, if you do something, he's going to turn you in. He's a rat. He's a snitch. Be careful. You get a snitch jacket, next thing you know, you're not getting cover and you're not getting backup. And then you got people, you know, you got other cops running around. Oh, that never happens. You know, cops, squeak clean. That's BS. Look, people in the military aren't in the job of going around turning into military. Most people who have any job does not get ahead or promote by turning in their coworkers and doing all that. So if you're looking at the Lucifer effect in the horse world or in any part of your world itself, whether it be in your family, on who's in charge and who isn't, and the fallouts and the thing, whether it's in your job, whether it's in a school or a class, whether it's in a course that you're taking, whether it's in the horse world, there's all these factors at play. So it's very easy to be on the outside and say how wrong or how somebody couldn't do that and not justify it versus being on the inside. You know, these Muslims that are out here blowing shit up and killing people and strapping on bodies, I mean, from the outside, everybody's like, they're crazy. How could they do that? You know, what would make somebody use their kid? In their mind, they've been indoctrinated to follow Allah, to follow a religion, to follow the 72 virgins, whatever. That's all they know. They can't go against it because they'll get stoned or whatever. So that for their own safety, protection, and survival, they go with the flow. And then it becomes indoctrinated that they believe this and they understand it and they're doing a greater good and they have an enemy that they're fighting. And so when a 13-year-old straps on a bomb and blows up a bunch of innocent people knowing he's going to die and people are like shocked, like, how could somebody do that? It's very easy how they could do it. You know, religion is a process of indoctrination. They get you as a kid, they tell you things. I was in Catholic school, I was a Catholic, and I mean, it was God this and this and you're going to hell. And I mean, it was all indoctrination and used fear and lack of knowledge. And if you question a religion, you were kind of called sacrilegious and you shouldn't question God. And religion is the same thing as the government or, you know, the military or any other organization. It's about making you part of the team, and you're either with us or against us. And if you show us any signs that you're not with us, then we're going to isolate you, we're going to talk about you, we're going to come together with the people that believe, and then you're going to be on the outside. So there's that will and want to survive to be on the inside. And, you know, I'm sure I just pissed off a bunch of religious people now. Oh, how could you say that? Look, every religion thinks they're right. Every war, you want to see a good war movie, watch Troy. I love that movie. I don't know who the guy, I think it might be Brad Pitt. I don't know who plays Achilles. But he does a great job, and that movie just shows so many lessons on war, and just, it's a great stinking movie, but, you know, I even forgot where the hell I was going, how that came up, but that movie just has a lot of great lessons in it, and I remember at one point they go to war, because one of the persons says, I had a sign from God, I saw an eagle carrying a snake, and that was a sign that we're going to win, and the son was like, God signs? He goes, we're going to go to war over an eagle flying a bird, and his father was like, don't question the gods. We attack tomorrow. And they end up destroying the whole country, getting every woman and children killed because the religion was so old and the king was so into listening to the gods, so you had some guy there who was close to the gods giving commands, and when the son questioned it, he was told, hey, I don't care if you're leading the army or not. I'm the king. Guess what? We're attacking tomorrow. I don't care what you think. And he lost his son, the whole city burned, because we went to war over a bird carrying a snake, and somebody said it was a sign from God. So, hell, I've already just pissed off all the religious people in the world. Whatever, now I'm going to get a hate mail from church people. All right, we'll end that there. Hopefully that helps you understand a little bit better on how this whole indoctrination and understanding the Lucifer effect, how good people can appear to be doing bad things, because you don't understand where they came from, what they've been told, what their belief system is, how have they been programmed and indoctrinated or brainwashed or taught to believe what they believe. And when they do these things that seem so odd to you, they have good reason in their mind on why they do it. Okay? All right, we'll end that there.